take Michael Jackson down there, and wish everybody happy Halloween and happy Wednesday, and thank you for joining us for creating an effective website for 2020. This is yet another installment in the Webolutions webinar series. My name is Mike Hanbury. I'm Director of Business Development here at Webolutions, and with me, as always, is my colleague Jack Schneider. Jack, want to just
hey, everybody.
Say hello? Yeah, Jack's going to help me out. Thank you, Jack, with moderating your questions. And try to keep me on time, which I will endeavor to do. We do time out right at about an hour for this, and so I'll try to get you going. We're going to talk about creating an effective website today, let's see what we have here. We have a little bit of information about Webolutions. There are some people who are joining us for the first time and who don't know our company very well. We sure appreciate you being here. We are a website digital marketing agency. We started building websites in 1994, back before anybody knew what that was. Literally, within there being 90 days of such a thing as a website, Webolutions was building them. So it's not possible to have a more longevity in the industry and to have seen more changes and really to have led more changes than we have. We've constructed more than 2,000 websites. We are constantly highly ranked in a number of different places, very proud of our work. Our purpose is to empower passionate people to thrive, and that is the approach that we take with everything we do, including website design. And we're going to share with you today some of the things about our approach that make our websites more effective, and hope you can apply them to your own, or even better, give us a call and let's work together. We offer a free website analysis, and here's what we're going to do if you give us a call or shoot us an email or contact us. This is if you're evaluating whether or not wherever you are in the stage of evaluating if you're going to have a website, if you're planning on having a website, should this be the year that we update our website? And by the way, your website partner probably has a fiduciary responsibility to just inform you that the way the world works is that every 5 years you should plan to redo your website. Things happen, right? The websites slow down because they get stuff loaded into them, big pictures, plugins. They get the little pieces of software within them that need to be updated, and sometimes the plugins, you know, don't keep pace; they need to be replaced. Things change, right? Somebody's going to invent the smartphone, and suddenly your website's going to need to be mobile friendly. When once upon a time there was no such thing as that. Your screen size, high definition television is going to replace standard definition television, and your screen sizes are going to change from a 4:3 ratio to a 16:9 ratio. Then that mandates a change, right? Because there's all this negative space that your marketing team should be saying that should be used to deliver our message and connect with our people and engage. And so those are the things that we'll look at, some of the things that we'll look at in terms of how you are positioned to succeed with your current website. We offer a free website analysis. Make plans, y'all, to join us. So we're doing it a little quicker this time because of the holidays. 3 weeks from now, November 20th. Okay. We'll be talking about digital marketing trends to consider in 2020. We're trying to take this as a kind of stair step and build upon each other. So today we'll teach you how to, we'll talk about how to build an effective website. And next month we're going to go market that. Take it to market and try to do and do the things you need to do. Generate more inbound leads and take advantage of the trends in the most cost-effective way possible. We've got a really great set of things to talk about. We've talked with our in-house experts and have some really great content for you next month. So go ahead and make some plans, mark your calendars, and please join us next month for November 20 for another free webinar in the Webolution series. About me, hi, Mike Hanbury, and there's some information about me. And before I had this position as the chief revenue officer, if you will, the sales guy here at Webolutions, I led the digital marketing team. And it was my job, me and my team's job, to take the website, to influence the strategy, the digital strategy that went into the websites, and then to take those websites and make them go, all right? And so when I when I do speak about these things, it really is from a point of a couple things. One, I do have some background in this industry, and I get the opportunity every day to work with experts here at Webolutions who are the best in the business at doing this. Let's just jump right into it. Ah, housekeeping. How to take questions. Use the chat function, if you would, please, to send in your questions. Jack will compile them. There are a few breaks in the program where I'll pause and take some questions, and we'll respond to them, and then we'll just keep our eye on the time. We're going to get you out of here at the top of the hour, so we'll keep an eye on the time. But if you have questions, please go ahead and type them in to the chat function, and then there are a few points here where we're going to pause and take questions. The first thing that we want to talk about in terms of effective website creation is positioning, right? What do we mean by that? First of all, you need to understand, before you build the website, where you need an objective assessment about where this goes. You want the website and probability to score for some terms. It's important before you decide that to do some homework and understand your competitive landscape, your industry, the market. What are the trends of keywords that are relevant to you? Discover your full universe of relevant keywords. Identify what they signal about the person who is using those keywords, be they, we'll talk more about this next month, this way or this way, right? One of the trends we'll talk about next month is going to be voice search, and that is how that's changing optimization. Google, we'll talk about this next month too, just the other day, Google announced another big major algorithm update, and it's about time, by the way. It's called BERT, B-E-R-T. No relation to Ernie, although I'm sure those jokes will be forthcoming from someone funnier than me, funnier than I am. It's about content. I was head of the online and marketing department here when the last big major Google algorithm update rolled out, Panda and Penguin, which were really about links, and that was a really good change for the way that the internet is used. And this looks like it's going to be a good change too, and it takes into account a lot of semantics about what you mean. One of the great articles I read, I think it was Search Engine Journal, gave the example about how a cow, where my mom lives in East Texas, well, we have cows on the property, and it is a bovine animal. Ooh, it's where milk comes from. There are parts of New England where a cow is fish, right? It's a sea bass. So even if you typed in fishing, well, Google still gave you bovinity and didn't talk about sea bass if you did a search about cow fishing. This update changes all that. And so big focus on content, and applause to Google for getting focused and making that happen for us. So you want to understand what's happening in the marketplace. What are the trends? What kind of impacts should we plan for? Trends in keyword search volume, where your competitors are. One of the things that we do and talk about competitive positioning here is that there are terms frequently that people want to score for, and they're very competitive. We have terms, for example, we have clients, for example, the insurance business, who would love to score on page one for auto insurance, and you can probably do that in the local pack, but an organic research for or a paid placement for auto insurance, unless you suddenly become Lemu the Emu or Flow from Progressive or Mayhem or Bumba da Bumba da Bum Bum Bum, you are not scoring for auto insurance. Okay, it's way too expensive, and so we want to know this before we go into it. Right, we'll plot our strategy behind these things, and also within your organization, what is your bandwidth? Right, we work with clients, for example. There's no set way necessarily that we work with. You have talents, you have time, you have capabilities. Let's complement those, and we can talk about like where, how best to synergize those things. But it doesn't make sense for you, for example, to sign on to take on part of a program that's going to make your program successful if you're never going to get around to having the time to do that. So these are the some of the upfront objective assessments in getting an effective website out the door. Up online. Here's an example of where we might start with competitive research. Now, we're going to use an example here of something that we did recently. We did another webinar for the financial industry. And I kept using this, I kept this both in terms of time for my own efficiency, but also because, man, if you can make this work within a highly regulated, highly competitive industry like finance, the rest of us are going to be in good shape if we use this kind of model. So, but what we'll do is we'll take this as a high level and just get a snapshot about how you stack up versus your competition in terms of these high level digital marketing indicators and these key performance indicators, and look at a number, and this will guide us in terms of being able to advise you. Do we need more content on the site? Does the site need to be bigger? If so, where? And is our inbound link profile a plus or a minus? And in what way should we proactively manage that to improve our ranking vis-a-vis our competitors? Are we creating content? Are we marketing it effectively? Are we using social media? And in this case, we got to fix this. So kudos to Super Credit Union. But they have a mobile-friendly website. Major factor for that. So we want to look at that. Just understand what the competitive landscape is and where the gaps are, and that will influence a lot of things. How we build the website and how we go to market with it. A data-driven assessment to marketplace command and competition. So in this case, our client there, what you'll see here on the left there is keywords, and we're having a discussion with them about where those keywords rank. And we have the best keyword and competitive strategy system in the business. And I know we have some competitors on there online. You're welcome. We're glad to have you. Rising tide lifts all boats. But I'm not going to go into detail about how we do that, except to say that it's the same way you should be doing it. You're probably not. We're more than happy to discuss that with anybody who calls in for our free website analysis or for any other reason. We've got some, but we want to understand your full universe of keywords. And you'll see some very short tail terms here. We call short tail, little terms, right? And if you type in car, right, so this is for a credit union, and if you type in car, well, you know, maybe that person's looking for a car loan, but that's a very broad term. You're probably not going to try to score for the word car. So we're going to break that down and get it into something that's meaningful for you and in line with the journey that your prospective buyer is on, et cetera. We'll document your rank. You want to know what the volume of searches are for that term within a geographic area. Just do you do business within a metro area, within a state, like attorneys, for example, are licensed in a state. And so you don't care what the U.S. global search volume is. And search volume in this case, by the way, is how many times this word gets used in searches on a 30-day average, on a rolling 30-day average in Google. And we are talking about Google because Google is used 70% of the time. It owns 70% of the search marketplace. The second most used search engine is YouTube, 20%. And YouTube is owned by Google. So you could make an argument that says Google owns 90% of the search market. So that's where we look and where we get our data. So you want to define the area in which it matters to you, where these searches are coming from, and ascertain what the volume of it is. That's not the end of it, but it's a key indicator where you start. Competition. These are percentages, and that is an aggregate. That competition column is an aggregate number about how many other relative number about how many other web pages are signaling to Google that they would also like to score on page one for that term. The holy grail, to oversimplify here, for an SEO geek, wonk, expert. Is you want a very relevant search term which shows an immediate intent to purchase with a large search volume and a very small rate of competition. That's like search for the Holy Grail. You never find that, but that's what you're looking for, all right? You're trying to find something that gets you in that ballpark. That CPC means cost per click, which we use to calculate a value. And we take the amount of traffic that is available for our clients that is actually getting to your website, and use that as part of a figure to evaluate, give you a monetary evaluation of the organic traffic that is available to you, all part of our process. But this is competitive research that you're going to want to have to put into your website. Now, There are a lot of that's our approach, okay, to get that keyword research and to know these things, and then to bake that into the website, including into the URL structure. Now there are, you may hear from other folks who have stopped doing this because years ago Google started writing in their best practices that they were going to devalue keywords, the impact of keywords in their algorithm. And so for years, the book has said that, but the results have not reflected any change. Okay, so when you, the difference between book smart and street smart. One of the things we're always going to encourage you to do is test against theory. Okay, so if somebody said something, that's an assertion, and when it comes from Google, well, that's a worthy assertion, and you go check that, and there are good things that they want to do, and there are things that they cannot do, and they will never be able to extricate or devalue that weight. That is content that the algorithm consumes. It consumes it early. It's extremely relevant to what's going on there. And so these keywords, this goes into your URL plan. It gets overlaid over your information architecture plan. More on that later, I'm sure. We want to evaluate the marketplace reflective. Okay, trends, lesson learned. Strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, threats. You know, I went to business school, so there's a way to do this that's very thorough and then the other way to do it, which is the way that most businesses do it, is you whiteboard it, right? But you look at your competition. When you've got competition, competitive research, and you've done this, and you've looked at them in terms of messaging and in terms of their online placement, well, then you can ascertain what your opportunities and threats are. And then your strengths and weaknesses are born of a look inward, right? These are internal factors. And so you look at what your strengths and weaknesses are internally. In this case, we're talking about as it regards to the website and what are critical issues that are happening right now or that are going to come to and they're going to come to fruition and how would we speak to those? How are there engagement opportunities, both in terms of things that we should talk about that would help us achieve our goals and things that we can talk about that will fend off the villains in our lives as we move forward. Branding and unique positioning. Also, still talking about the website here. So one of the first things we do, and before we can design a user experience, right? So a website does a couple of things. Most people who work with us want the website to do a couple of things. One, they want it to work basically as a sales agent, all right? They want it to generate inbound leads or engagement, or they want it to serve as an employment recruiting tool. They want it to attract people, all right? They want things about the website to work with the search engine to attract relevant people to their website. And then the website has to convert that, all right? We expect an action. We want people to do something once they get there. Download our ebook, buy our product, subscribe to our newsletter, something, right? Fill out our job application. There's something we want people to do once they arrive there. So what is that, right? So first of all, to whom are we speaking? We are not all the same. We process information differently. And so one of the first things we want to do is clearly define our target personas, all right? Who are they? Demographics and psychographics are great. None of us have ever made a purchase decision because we fit into a demographic. So that's a start, and it's not where we end. We need to understand how they process information, what their decision-making process is, what influences that decision. What are what do we want to communicate to these people, and what obstacles can we expect to encounter in achieving our communications goals with them? So if we're going to design a website, it shouldn't be, do you like it? Because our designers like it. Our designers think this is pretty slick. Do you like it? That's where revision upon revision upon revisions comes from. You want to minimize the amount of revisions that go into your website development process, and you do that by first agreeing who it's for and how they process information. So then you can design a user experience to meet them where they are and generate all kinds of little micro yeses through that. Our core competencies and our strengths to leverage, what do we do well, right? This goes into our messaging, right? And let's be honest about who we are and what can we do, and then be honest internally about, you know, we need to do this better, and so how do we acknowledge that, and so where does this happen? How does this fit within our messaging and our user experience on the website? And this last bullet point is very important, I think. We believe in showcasing the transformation not, hey, buy our product. But here's the transformation that's available to you when you make us a part of your life, okay? If we sell something and they buy our product or they sign on for our service, okay, great, right? They got something that they wanted and we made a little money doing what we do. But that's not a real impact, okay, in someone's life, right? And our imagery, if we want to speak to people at the emotional level, which is where all the decisions are made, okay, we need to show and reinforce the decision that's being made here and showcase in our imagery, in our content, the transformation, all right? I'm here, now I'm here, right? So let's live here, right? Let's show people here's where you can be with us. Now, we talk about a brand quite a bit. And in sales presentations, I'll ask people, you know, we use an example everybody knows, McDonald's, right? We'll say, what's McDonald's brand? And somebody always says Golden Arches, right? Somebody says Big Mac. If you talk to anybody in franchising, they always, always, always say consistency or land ownership is another thing. If they've seen the founder recently, that comes up. But here's the point. It's an individual relationship between the entity and the thing, right, and your business. The brand will be a memory bank that is formed over time through memories that we create, all right? Effective brands, like Coca-Cola, form positive associations between what they stand for in the world and moments of happiness in people's lives. Why does Coca-Cola sponsor the Olympics? Because Coca-Cola says we refresh the world. How do we do that? We connect people. We bring people together. So why does Coca-Cola sponsor football games and Holding Hands Take the World to Sing and Christmas and the Olympics? Because that's where people come together. It's consistent with their brand, it's right in line with their messaging, and it saves them from having to come to us and saying, our sugar water is delicious, our packaging is really cool, please buy it. Not a compelling message, right? It hits the wrong part of the brain, and the reason that Coca-Cola is so successful is because, besides having a delicious product, they speak to us on an emotional level. It's the same thing that Apple does. It's the same thing that Harley-Davidson, okay? People don't tattoo Harley-Davidson on their skin permanently because Harley-Davidson sells motorcycles. They do it because Harley-Davidson represents freedom. And if you go to Harley-Davidson's website, that's what you'll see, all right? You'll see that lifestyle. You'll see the freedom communicated right there. If you're that type of person, it'll strike you, and you'll want to know more. You will engage more deeply. And then the next thing you know, you're buying bandanas. Harley makes more money on their merchandise, on their paraphernalia, than they do on their motorcycles every single year. All right, well, going to do this, and then I'll pause and take a few questions because we've got them coming in. And this is what I mean. So here's a cross section of the human brain. Many of you might have seen read Simon Sinek's book, Start with Why, or seen his TED talk about how great leaders inspire action. And in those things, he gives you the golden circle, the why, how, the what, and he says this is this aligns with a cross section of the human brain. This right here is that cross section, okay? Like I said, we had to go validate this. We thought that was pretty good, right? And right in line, messaging wise, with Webolutions approach, we like this. Had to go validate it. This is how we got there. And so there are three parts of our brain: the reptilian brain, the involuntary stuff, blinking, breathing. That's hot. And our neocortex, right, which is where data gets recorded. All right. So we're giving you a bunch of facts today. They are landing in your neocortex, and it's going to record this fact and this fact and this fact and this datum and this datum and this datum, and then that's going to sit there. And is that going to make you a better marketer? Is that going to give you a more effective website? No, it is not. But it will if your limbic brain engages, right, and decides to do something with that information. 100% of our decision-making capacity is housed within our mammalian brain, our limbic brain. It is the part of our brain that controls trust and loyalty. And so you could make the argument, and we do, that every decision is made because I trust it. Every vote we cast, every buying decision we make is, I understand this. I trust it. And then brands like Apple and Coke and Harley-Davidson command loyalty, all right, because they do it right and they're consistent and they're clear over and over and over again. I'm going to leave this slide up while I go take a few questions here that have come in. We're doing okay on time, I think. All right. What is the single most important thing? That's a good question. What is the single most important thing my website must do? I would say that depends, right, on what your goals are. And that's part of that objective, that objective analysis that we do on the first part. As I say, in any case, it's to convert the visitor to take the action that you want them to take, right? What are your goals, right? Do you set goals? Do you need to be more profitable? Nonprofits, we need to move more people through our program or sign up more donors or live there. Government entities that we work for, need greater engagement, all right, from their constituencies, right, and to get the information that people need literally to live their lives to them more readily and easily. So define that single goal gets defined. From a business standpoint, which is where I think this particular question comes from, given who asked it, but first get the visitors. SEO, digital advertising, something, right? You need to draw those visitors who come by referral, who are with construction companies, right, who just do not get a lot of their business from SEO or digital marketing. It's all by referral. Okay, so somebody says they refer, well, that website needs to speak, here's who we are, and here's what we do, and here's why you need to talk to us, okay? It needs to convert the visitor. When people land on your website, I think this is important to know. It's a good time to talk about that with that brain up there. The brain decides whether or not people like your website in 0.05 seconds. That is how much time we have to make a first impression. That is how much time we have to convince somebody that they need to spend another 0.05 seconds with us, and so forth and so on. And 61% of that decision is based on color and imagery alone. All right, that's just the way the brain processes that information. So the colors and the imagery, that transformational imagery that you show is going to be very important, and so is a very clear message about why you're here. All right, this is the right place for you to get or learn about these things. Very, very important there on your homepage. Very clear, immediate messaging. More than happy to go further into that offline. Give me a call. We'll take two more questions here. Okay, we offer multiple service lines, which to showcase. Excellent question, and it's one that comes up a lot. And what that means is we've got these different deals, right? We have 5, 10, 15, 20, maybe 100 different service lines or 100 different products, all this stuff. And what I think comes in, this is coming at is prioritizing the message. We're working with somebody now who has a very established business, but it's kind of stopped growing. And in part because when you go to the website, they've got all of these products right in front of you, and all of them are for sale, and all of them are very good. But it's too much information for the brain to process, right? So we have to chunk out the information and understand how the visitor arrives at the site and what they're looking for and how they process information so that we can get it to them and we can categorize effectively and develop what we call conversion funnels for that. So the questions that I would ask here is, do your service lines intersect? Do they build on each other? Is one a loss leader? You know, do you break even? Do you take a loss on the front end because it leads to an ongoing relationship that is more profitable for you? Or are there higher margin things that you should emphasize? And it's important to be who you want first. And then it's important to understand that we are humans and we are imperfect. And it is one thing to say, hey, we did the data research. We did expert analysis on it, and we formed a data-driven hypothesis, and we put it to work. You have to test the hypothesis, all right? So test your theories, all right? Do A/B testing on your website. A/B testing, A/B this versus that on your calls to action, on the placement of your different content areas and blocks and so forth. There's lots of different ways to run those tests. But do run the test and do learn from the test and then take the things that you learn and put them and test them again, right? That's part of effective effective website development. Okay, this is a fair question. Why are you talking about positioning and research that is not just about the website? Fair. And we did say effective website. Your website is as effective as your marketing. If we deliver a message and a brand, an imagery, and so forth on a website that is inconsistent with what you have on a lead behind, on a piece of print advertising, and the way you answer the phone, and the content that a prospective client hears in a sales meeting, et cetera, then your website's ineffective, and so is every other part of your marketing, all right? So yes, we do up front, establish these things which are applicable beyond the website. And then we apply them to the website, and we apply them to every other thing that we do, or the client applies them to everything that they do with marketing and messaging. Because your conversion rates go up, you are more profitable. The velocity through your sales pipeline, sales and marketing pipeline, is expedited when your prospect sees clearly and experiences clearly and consistently across the gamut. That same consistent message. Why? Because it generates trust. And if they hear the same thing clearly and consistently across all media and over again, then and they choose not to do business with you, that's going to have to be okay, because they've made an informed decision, and it wasn't going to work out anyway. All right? All right. Hope that helps. Let's talk about messaging, one of my favorites, all right? We'll talk about copy here because it's what's on my slide, and so it's really easy way to talk about that. So the evolution of your marketing message, so the message that's going to go on your website, okay? If I wanted to purchase coffee at a commodity level, which is cheapest and easiest, and then I could go down to the market, and I could to the spot market, and I could purchase a burlap sack full of coffee beans. It looks just like in that picture, and I could take them home, I could roast them up, I could grind them up, and I could pay $1.58 a pound to make coffee. Boy, that sounds like a lot of trouble. That's probably why I've never done that in my life, and I don't even know where the spot market is. I just know that's how that happens. Instead, someone comes along and says, hey, you don't have to do that. I'll take care of that. I will grow the beans. I will select the best beans. I will roast the beans, and I will put them, and then sometimes I'll even grind them up for you, and I will put them in a resealable container to keep them fresh, and I will rent space on a grocery store that is shelf space at a grocery store that's a couple of blocks from your house, and then the next time you're at the market, you can just grab my ready-made product, and instead of paying $1.50 a pound, you'll pay me $5, $6, $7, $8, $9 a pound, depending on how uppity you are about your coffee. Is that okay? And everybody says, yes, that's much better. Yes, thank you. I'm more than happy to do that. Then somebody comes along and says, you don't even have to do that, right? That business about going to the market and picking that up and making your own coffee is for the birds, because I have opened a diner, and I'm going to make the coffee, and I'm going to put cream and sugar on your table, and I've got a server who is going to make sure that your ceramic cup is full of hot, bitter, brown, delicious liquid for as long as you're willing to stay with me. And now I'm giving you the same thing at a service component. And the main part about this, I guess, or one of the main parts, is the next time you're sitting down for breakfast at the diner, don't do the math, all right, on what the coffee is costing you, because it's a lot of money. And when we ask people what coffee costs at Denny's or at Perkins, people will never know. $1.50, $2.50, well, that's a big difference, right, percentage-wise, right? And it's usually around $2.50, $3, and it comes out to about $8 a pound. But it doesn't matter, right, because you're there for this service. It's part of the thing that just comes with it. And many of you have probably already asked me in the punchline here, Starbucks, right, has us waiting in line at 2 o'clock in the afternoon to pay $125 a pound for coffee, all right? So we don't order coffee at Starbucks, right? There's no such thing as a large coffee at Starbucks. You can get medium roast, you can get a tall medium roast, you can get a grande dark roast, and most of us get an upside down double shot, blah, 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 right? It takes my wife 5 minutes to order her drink at Starbucks. But she does this loyally, because Starbucks provides an experience, right? It's not just about this service. She doesn't get coffee, she gets a handcrafted drink, not brought to her by a server, but made for her by a barista. And she's got a loyalty card that she just waves and it's happened. And really, the story that I tell, probably too often, is she's going through the drive-thru. And Starbucks was good coffee, right? It was convenient and it was there. But it really wasn't, we didn't see it as a real different deal than any of the other coffee places that I acknowledge. Starbucks changed the world. They built this industry, right, in America. But there were plenty of copycats, right? Plenty of other Me Toos that came on. Brewers, Caribou, Peaberry, a whole bunch of them that popped up. And my wife is going through the drive-thru at Starbucks, and they handed her a drink and said, "Would you like to pay it forward?" And she said, "I don't know what that means." And he said, "That car that just drove off bought that drink. You owe me nothing. But if you like, you can buy the drink for the people behind you." Okay, so she ends up spending $14 to buy two drinks for the people behind her instead of the $6 she was going to get for hers. And she felt fantastic about it. And from that moment forward, having that logo on her paper cup as she walked through her day and went about her business, no longer said, "I bought coffee." It said, "I believe in doing nice things for myself and other people." Totally different, right? And in that moment, became a Starbucks loyalist. That was no other place to get coffee. Powerful stuff, right? And we, in our messaging, we have to decide where we land on the continuum. If we talk about ourselves as a product and we price ourselves as an experience, it breaks, it's not trustable, people don't buy. Let's say we've done what we call market positioning. And we have reverse engineered these personas. We've clearly defined our target personas. And we've developed your full universe of keywords, right, that are relevant to you. And all that stuff that goes with it, your current rankings and the search volume and the competition rate. And we've looked at your competitive landscape, right? We've looked at you versus your competitors, both in terms of that grid that I show you and how they message themselves, okay, and what we can glean from that and other competitive information. And we've defined who we are, and we've said, here's what we stand for in the world, and here's going to be the foundation, right, of our market position, of our unique market position. Okay, now, let's talk about content for that website and how we're going to message ourselves, okay? Let's build some standards. And again, yes, I want to acknowledge these are not just for the website. They're for everything. They're for the way you answer the phone. They're for the way your salespeople talk to prospects at meetings. They are for your print pieces, for your radio ads, whatever it is that you do. These are standards that go across all things, all right? And here are the USPs, unique selling propositions. It's one of the reasons that we look at competitors. We want to be the only. We're the only something that something, right? Otherwise, if we also offer it, commodity product, if we've also got it, well, then eventually we're competing on price, and it's very difficult to win and be profitable there if it's a race to the bottom. We want to identify vocabulary. I mentioned Starbucks, right? That small, medium, large, tall, grande, venti, barista. It creates loyalty, right? And recall, and generates referral. So at the very least, even if we're not going to go to the full step, to have like that unique brand vocabulary, which we love developing with people, let's at least agree on what we call our people. We have employees, or do we have team members? We have salespeople, we have representatives, or we have consultants. What are they? Let's define that. We use these words. Our voice and our tone. Are we silly? Are we serious? Whatever we are, let's be that in everything that we do. And do we speak about ourselves in the first and third person, or do we say we help you? And there's no right or wrong answer necessarily, right? It depends on who you are and how you're going to market, who your people are, and how they need to be communicated with. But let's be clear and consistent across all of our communications with it, perhaps especially on our website. Okay? These are some of the things that also go, ancillary to the website. But we also want to know that last bullet point's important: effective KPI tracking, analysis, testing, optimization. Man, we want a baseline. We want to know how effective this is for you. So let's establish key performance indicators and which ones are relevant to you, to your business goals, all right? These that intersect with the tool. What can the tool deliver you that's going to help you achieve your business goals? And then let's track it, okay? Let's measure it on an ongoing basis as to how we're doing and figure out what adjustments need to be made to make things go faster and be more successful, all right? Our information architecture, okay, I mentioned this, and we do reverse engineer this. We get that data, okay, who your persona is, how they process information, your business, here's who we are, here's why we exist, here's what we do, okay, here's how we do it. And that'll help us stack the information on the website and order, right, that makes sense to Google, to your visitor, and then we will overlay our SEO search engine optimization, our keyword and competitive analysis on that to say, here is an information architecture. Okay. I want to pause here before we go into this next part here about aligning your website marketing strategy. Do a quick time check. 41, perfect. Take a few more questions. You are presenting a waterfall project model. It's true, I am. Isn't the industry going agile? Well, I kind of have talked about agile a little bit here. To get the website up, so for people who don't live in this world, okay, waterfall is a project management model, right? It has a beginning and an end, right? This happens, this happens, this happens, this happens, this happens. You may have a Gantt chart where a number of things are occurring primarily, but it has a beginning, and then it's done, okay? And that's waterfall. And then agile development is constantly moving, right? App development is definitely done this way. If you have a mobile app on your phone, and all of you do, there's agile development that is going on there. The bug, the application is constantly given bug reports, software usage, and then you've got programmers and others who are looking at that data and saying, okay, we need to make a update to the software. The software that's in your cell phone, it's in your mobile phone, when you get that says, hey, it's time for a system update, that is agile development. That is an example of agile development. And the way that your website does agile development is through that testing and through software monitoring and through those reports that we have the system to provide you and give you and offer the analysis and recommendations on. To get the website up first, that's a waterfall project every single time, okay? When you go from not having it or from having this and need to turn into this, you have to establish a beginning and an end to that project. And so, yes, you are correct. I am talking about waterfall, but the model itself does become agile thereafter. Okay, next question. You mentioned custom functionality. In WordPress, can't all that just be done by out-of-the-box plugins? Okay, so I haven't mentioned WordPress, but obviously somebody knows. We do work primarily in WordPress, and we, here at Webolutions, we do have what we call an enhanced WordPress platform. We started working in WordPress about 10 years ago, and we like the ease of use, very easy to use. We like the content management system. We like the SEO friendliness. We liked a lot about it. We didn't like the restrictions that that the theme construct introduced. And this is where, and WordPress, by the way, has pretty much won the content management system, the CMS website wars. It will get another report on this here in a couple of months. It happens at the beginning of the year, but usage of WordPress has gone up year after year after year. And at the beginning of 2019, the report came back that said WordPress is powering more than a third of all websites on the internet. And there's no other platform that comes anywhere close to that. So we do use WordPress. What we did was we created what we call an enhanced WordPress platform, where you get the interface and you get the SEO, SEO benefits and the other benefits, but it's still flexible. The theme construct assumes that you are going to fit into this box. And the website construction process is full of, well, the theme doesn't support that. We'll have to add a child theme, or we have to code an exception to the theme. And anytime you hear that, it ought to make you a little bit nervous, all right? You're just basically saying, yeah, we can build the house, but it's just not going to be as structurally sound over here, okay? And it should make you twitch a little bit. And so the website, it shouldn't be like that. You should be free to come with ideas and questions. Can it do this? The answer is always, yes, it can. Should it? And we should be free to come with recommendations about how things the website, you know, based on this data, based on this information that we've generated together, here are recommendations for how to make the website most effective, most powerful and effective. And our enhanced WordPress platform got us out of that box and allowed us to have that relationship and the dialogue with our clients. And then we continue to evolve the platform. The question with that background, thank you, you mentioned custom functionality. In WordPress, can't all that just be done by out-of-the-box plugins? Excellent question. And the short answer is no. I understand that's how the plugins present themselves, it's how they're marketed, but some customization is 100% of the time is required. Styling something has to be done, just like that out-of-the-box WordPress theme probably introduces too many limitations. If you're going to get that plugin and just plug it in, then it's going to be far less effective and not going to operate the way that you think it ought to operate, because the person who designed it and programmed it didn't have you in mind, didn't have your own business in mind when they programmed it. So I got to move on. But the long story short is that plugins do. And we do use plugins. We've got a series that we pre-qualified, and we got a stringent system for doing that. And we like WordPress, and we like working with the plugins. But the notion that you can have a custom website and then stick a plugin in there without customizing it is kind of upside down. So custom functionality. We do use WordPress plugins for custom functionality, but they almost always need to be stylized or have some kind of adjustment done to them. Last question for this part. How many rounds of revisions should I expect my website design to require? We expect two but we expect a minimal number of those because we do all of this work up front. And we are not doing it to please somebody in the room as much as we are doing it to market, be effective for those personas that we have identified. Really takes down the revision process. And then we have some tools that make it very easy and interactive to do that. Your money and your delay happens in design and programming, so do that last. Okay, get the blueprints right, get the structure, get all the work done, do all the homework, and then take the test. Okay, so the websites go over budget and over time. When you rush into design and development, and that's just not a good experience for anybody. So the short number. So if you're looking for a partner, look for a partner who's got systems, not to allow you to revise, but who's got systems to help you minimize the number of revisions in your process. Let's talk about aligning your website and marketing strategy. It's a good question. Aligning your website and marketing strategy. Okay, here's our brain. Our brain is back. We're going to talk about effectively telling your story on your homepage. This is where all your traffic is landing, right? Onto your website homepage. I don't want to belabor that point, right? But your transformation imagery, that first image, is so much of the battle. Okay, needs to appeal. All right, and I need to see myself in that image. Yes, that is me. Being where I want to be, right? That's why I'm doing this search. The end goal, all right? And maybe even showing me that there is triumph and transformation available that I haven't even considered yet, right? And again, not because I bought your stuff, but because I made you part of my life. Our imagery and videos and that's another good question that comes up is a lot of websites use motion. And if you look at statistics and says, yeah, video, and that's all done. Before you do that, I want you just to take a moment and go find a website and check it out on your mobile phone, okay? See if you would be happy with the download speed, right, if you were to use video in that slot. If you're a video production company, that's a whole other discussion, right? Because that's what you're offering. Your download speed, is it a good visual experience? Does it welcome you to the site? Is it a good experience for you? And before you say, hey, we need video here, do an evaluation of yourself and see if that's what. And by and large, it's It's because about 80% of the, statistically speaking, for most industries, 80% of the initial traffic, the first time somebody sees your website, is going to be on a mobile device, on a phone, more to the point, on a smartphone. And then a conversion, a greater engagement for like a consulting business like ours, right? If you're, especially if you're talking about stuff that has commas in it, then that conversion probably happens on a, for I have off the 10 fingers to go. But the mobile experience, you know, think mobile first with that and decide how that's going to go. When we open up with our phone, how long do we spend on that screen? It's not long before we're scrolling and going down to the once upon a time was people didn't scroll, people scroll, you scroll, I scroll, everybody scrolls, it's okay. And it's just something we should acknowledge. And we talked about these other things, and they need to go into the website. Yeah, here's another good point. Let them discover, let your user discover, okay? When we do advertising campaigns, pay-per-click advertising, we drive traffic to landing pages, which strip out the top navigation. We pay for you to be here and to receive this message. So I don't want any unsupervised thought going on up here. I want you focused on this thing and to convert and to talk to me about this thing. If any other type of web page has navigation, has other things, has internal links that suggest, hey, well, if you're interested in SEO, we probably should have that content. Here's a link to how we handle content. These kind of things, right? Let them discover, let them know, let them engage, and give them opportunities to learn more about you and to their website. Our marketing superhero is back. For those of you who have joined us before, here he is. I love this guy. We want to, and he's a superhero today because he's figured out of a line his marketing and website strategy. All right, he's got a marketing strategy. It's clear. He's going to put it to work on his website. He's figured out his information architecture. He knows very clearly who he's talking to because he's developed his target personas. He's made business decisions based on his business data and his digital data, his competitive and his keyword information. He's built a navigation and a URL structure that is going to maximize his appeal to the Google algorithm, to the search engines. He's got a user experience, which takes into account that marketing plan, those personas, that speaks to those keywords, that incorporates the messaging standards that they're going to make his life so much easier for everything going forward. Talk about revisions. Okay, if you've got a platform, you've got messaging standards, there are very few revisions, right? The boss says, well, I like this. You say, well, here's what the brand platform says. And you've got a user experience that that reflects that. And then functional alignment, okay? So can my website do this? Yes, it should, as it can. Let's talk about should it, right? I mean, sometimes that there are industry-relevant plugins that are pre-made, and they work perfectly well, and they don't do anything to forward your goals. Your goal, for example, is not to solve a math problem for your prospective client. It is to get your prospective client to talk to you, all right, to contact you, or to buy a product or something. And so any kind, and this is functionality, by the way, and custom, especially custom functionality is where a lot of the cost comes in developing a website. Time and cost gets increasing because custom functionality with the development of custom functionality. And our system is to look for ways, you know, what already exists. Are there third-party tools that we can incorporate here and get that timeline down and that functionality and the cost down for that? And so effective is also cost effective, but make sure that the functions that you're putting in your website support your overall business goals and aren't just a cool thing that you decided to put on there. Content rules of thumb, time check real quick. Okay, we've got a few minutes. Our content rules of thumb, a content strategy. So that keyword analysis, that keyword competitive analysis ought to influence what kind of content we are going to create on an ongoing basis. Also, our persona development should. Who are they and how are they processing information? And are there things that we can communicate with them about that go beyond, hey, we sell this stuff. We've got new stuff to sell. If we are going to engage them, it needs to provide value beyond that. Excuse me. We need to have, so what is our content strategy? How are we going to do it? And what's the medium through which we are going to communicate this message? To our audience. So a clearly defined content strategy. who's going to do, what are we going to write about, who's going to write it, when's it going to be published, where's it going to be published. And on our website, we're probably talking about a blog on an ongoing basis. How does that fit in? Tell the story. We do a thing here called story branding. I don't have time to go into it. Maybe I do. I'll do it real quick. So there's an example of it here over my over my shoulder. We did this at an event where I'm not going to have time. But we do a thing called story branding. It's not ours. It was developed by a guy named Donald Miller. He's a very nice man. I've met him. Miller is a screenwriter in Hollywood. And he takes the formula that works for every Hollywood movie. Yes, there is a formula. And as soon as you read the book, or as soon as I explain this to you, it's going to change the way you watch movies forever. But that tried and true method might be applicable to the way that you tell your story on your website. And I'll just give you the spoiler here. The customer's the hero, and you're the guide. Is how we'll do that, right? SEO considerations, champion pages, pillar content needs to be identified, and the information that we generate up front informs all of that in the website process. I got just a couple of minutes here. Do I want to talk about this? You know what? This I'm gonna blast through this because I'm out of time and because we're gonna cover it next month. So tune in next month on the 20th. To cover that stuff that I didn't want to talk about, that I didn't have time to talk about today. A few more minutes. Jackie always sends out an email following this. We're going to include in it this self-evaluation worksheet. So you can look at your own website on your own time and decide if you understand your website's key ranking factors versus your competitor's websites. All right, this is not a homework assignment to go get that necessarily, but it's just a snapshot to say, hey, do we understand this, right? So before we go into creating a website, do we have the information available? Do we have the information we need to make it effective? And look at your messaging, right? Do you think it's a commodity, a product, a service, an experience, or are we showing the transformation? Are we telling a story, right? Have we identified a hero? Are we positioning ourselves as the guide? Do we show our people that we understand what obstacles they are confronting? Have we called them to action and given them a plan? And are we reminding them about the choice that they're making about triumph and transformation or tragedy, right? And usually tragedy is same old, nothing changes. People are looking for a new website, they're looking to come to your website because they want something to change in their life. That's one of the first questions that we ask, by the way, in persona development is what has changed in this person's life to suddenly care about what you have to say? It's an important question to understand. Our website is reverse engineered to capture SEO opportunities. Is our URL structure keyword optimized? Do we understand what our search volume and competitive, are we playing in fields where we can win? Do we have our title tags, our H1s, our body content, our interlinking strategy, our inbound link profile? I mean, are we ready? All right? Have we taken this into account before we have gone into the process of making a website? And finally, this will be the last one. Do we have the data systems and process to continually improve our website results? Somebody asked a question about Agile. This is what we're talking about, right? You know, so the website's great. We'll launch it, and we have to, just like we do with each other all the time, expect more. And expect it to get better. Your website should do that as well. Do we have, can we do that? Okay. Remind you all real quickly about our free website analysis that we offer anytime. Join us again next month and get the Halloween tunes going back here as we exit. And join us again next month, y'all. Thanks for being here. My name is Mike Hanbury. To my colleague Jack Schneider, thank you for joining us, and join us again next month as we talk about digital marketing trends to consider in 2020. We empower passionate people to thrive. Y'all go thrive.